Inspiring interviews with today's top landlords.
This is the Rental Income Podcast.
And now, Dan Lane.
I think this is pretty interesting. So you've actually tracked every penny that you've invested into your rental properties, from down payments, closing costs, any repairs or upgrades. Any money that you've invested, you can account for.
Yes. I've always been really good on personal finance, so I track all my expenses. But I do specifically track the rental stuff to the T, and I use Quicken software for that. But then what I do is I take that data, like the accumulated expenses and things like that, and I put them in my spreadsheets to generate the compound annual growth rate and stuff.
So we've got years of data to look at, and my guest has some properties that are local to him that he self-manages. He also has some out-of-state turnkey properties he bought that were fully renovated. They already had a tenant in place. And today on the podcast, he's going to share with us the truth about turnkey rental properties. And if he's actually making any money, are these investments really a good deal or not? Joining us on the podcast today from Florida is Joe DiSanto. We'll take a quick break. We'll come right back and we'll meet Joe. The first step in buying a rental property is to get pre-qualified. And I would suggest you work with a lender that specializes in working with investors, because the last thing you want to have happen is to get to closing and find out the money's not there and you can't close. The lender that I recommend is Chaley Ridge from Ridge Lending Group. She's a nationwide lender, and she'll pre-qualify you for free if you mention Rental Income Podcast. Find out more today. Contact Chaley at ridgelendinggroup.com. That's R-I-D-G-E, lendinggroup.com. NMLS 42056. When I'm doing research to buy a new rental property, there's a lot of different websites, apps, and then a spreadsheet that I use to do my analysis. It's really kind of a convoluted process. Well, there's a much easier way. There's an app called Ask Rick. That's R-I-C for Rental Income Calculator. Ask Rick makes it really easy to find and analyze rental properties. You can see all the properties for sale in an area. If something looks good, you can press one button. It'll analyze the property for you. It'll figure out the rent amount. It'll figure out your mortgage payment, all your expenses, and give you your cash flow. If you're ready to move forward, you can make an offer right there on the app, or you can send the information over to your realtor to do some more investigation into the property. You can try it out for free right now. Just search for Ask Rick. That's R-I-C, Ask Rick, in the App Store, or go to justaskrick.com. That's justaskrick.com. The team at Just Ask Rick is constantly working on making the app better. They just released an update to make the map load faster, and you can now schedule a tour by sending a calendar invite right in the app. If you tried it out before, you might want to give it another shot. If you haven't tried it yet, start your free trial today at justaskrick.com. Joe, before we talk about your returns, I want to understand what your portfolio looks like. So I think there's a pretty big range of returns that someone could make off rentals. So I just want to get some context to what we're talking about. So can you tell me what your rental portfolio looks like?
I have two residential rentals that I manage here in Florida near my house. I have one residential rental in Memphis, Tennessee. And then I am partners in a commercial building out in Los Angeles, which houses the business I used to be a partner in. If you went back to 2 years ago when I was still living in Los Angeles, it was a little different. I had about 10 properties then. I had three residential managed rentals in Memphis, Tennessee, three residential managed rentals in Kansas City, Missouri, two residential managed rentals in Austin, Texas. And collectively, I've transacted on about 16, real estate transactions total.
Well, I think this will be really interesting because you've got a lot of data, not just for the properties you own, but the properties that you've sold. So we can kind of walk through the whole life cycle and see the actual returns, including how much you made or lost when you sold the property. Now, I'm just wondering, out of your portfolio, are there some rentals that have almost been outliers, that have performed way above other rentals, and then some that haven't done well?
Yeah, I mean, luckily for me, they've all made money. And, you know, just to give the audience a little understanding of how I do this math and what results into me answering this question is I do like total return calculations on all my properties. And I do it for this reason. Like, I in real estate to have my money make money. Like, you know, I was jokingly say unless you like to go sit outside your rental property all day and just like look at it and soak it in.
Right. Yeah. We're there to make money.
You're doing this to make money. Right. So you really have to look at the performance of the investment and weigh it against some other kind of investment that might take less of your time. Because if you're making 10% compound annual growth, but you're working 20 hours a week to do it, well, you're really actually making a lot less because you're giving yourself a part-time job. Right. So like pretty much we're talking about the comparison to the stock market where I don't do absolutely anything. I hit a button, I'm in an investment and, you know, I want to know, is my real estate performing better than that?
Right.
And because if it's not, why would I do it? Because
it doesn't make sense. Time. You got to do much better than the stock market. So let's cut right to it. So what has your overall return been on all your rental properties?
Yeah, so far in all my investments, my calculation of like a weighted average return over the course of all the time has been about a 16% compound annual growth rate.
Great. Yeah, that's
which
awesome.
Is pretty damn good.
Yeah.
You know, and when I say weighted, you know, it's like I had 16 transactions, right? But, you know, some of them I was in for 10 years. Some of them I was in for 4 years. Some of them I put 200 grand into. Some of them I put 15,000 into. So you can't just average all those out the same because the time in and the money in versus the whole is different. So I kind of weight the time in versus total time and money in versus total invested funds. So I get a pretty good average of, you know, like, what, you know, how each property and its time and money in sort of like makes up the piece of that.
So talk to me about your portfolio. So I know you own rentals in different areas. Are there different categories of properties that you have?
Residential rentals or turnkey rentals is where I've gone out of state because California wasn't a good place to buy rentals. So I went out of state looking for cheaper stuff with better numbers, better stats. And worked with a few turnkey providers and bought residential rentals that way. Then I have had personally managed residential rentals, which I have now here in Florida. I've been slowly moving my equity from the managed rentals in the Midwest down to Florida where I am so I can manage it and they'll perform better. And then there's the commercial development stuff. Hmm. Like real estate, just like anything in life, the more work you put in, generally speaking, the more you're going to get out. So the turnkey is the least amount of work because literally you don't do anything. You don't find the house. You don't renovate the house. You don't find the first tenant even. You don't do any repairs because you're 1,000 miles away. You're pretty much just answering phone calls and emails and approve stuff. So it's about the most passive you can get for real estate investing outside of REITs or, crowdfunded deals.
But so with the turnkeys that you haven't seen a really good return on those?
They've worked out for me financially and on a return basis, but admittedly it's because of the appreciation. And a lot of the reason I'm getting out now and moving them into things I can manage myself and get more cash flow out of is because, you know, I want to cash in on the appreciation. So I fully admit that's what's pushed those returns. And I'm lucky in that sense because I don't think you should invest betting on appreciation. But I didn't go into it thinking that way. Like my hope was they were going to perform better on the cash flow front as well. They just haven't. You know, I've just learned at least – in my case, which is a pretty good swap, we're talking 8 managed residential rentals over 3 cities, Kansas City, Memphis, and Texas. You know, I have, you know, real averages of expenses and they just cost more to, you know, the overhead on them, expenses and maintenance and turnover, which is just higher than I was hoping it was going to be. I mean, turnkey providers, this is the performer they give you. This is their methodology. They shoot for the 1% rule, which is the rent is monthly rent is 1% of the total purchase price, right? And then you're going to have your taxes, insurance, and whatever. And most of these turnkey people, the big markets are one where tax bases are low, insurances are reasonable, and things like that. And then they put in, you know, your unknowns of expenses and vacancy at expenses and maintenance at 5% and vacancy at 5%. So when you put all those numbers together, you're going to get a performer that tells you you're going to get roughly 10% cash on cash return. Now, everyone knows at least 5% of expenses and vacancy at 5% of turnover is low. You know, maybe it's possible, but I doubled it thinking that my cash on cash return would probably be more like 5%. Well, I really needed to like almost quadruple it. I mean, at least triple it. So, because that's what it netted out, like my expenses, maintenance, and turnover on it for that three properties in Kansas City, Missouri was like 37-38% total. And in Memphis, which was better, it was still like high 20s. So what happened there was it pushed all those properties into continuous negative cash flow.
You know, that's really interesting because every turnkey company sells properties promising you cash flow and telling you you're probably not going to see appreciation. But the way it worked out is you saw appreciation, but you didn't see cash flow. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's not untrue about depreciation. Like a lot of these markets are just like, you know, steady Eddie, small markets, third tier cities, like, and they don't have big appreciation like your tier two and tier three cities like Austin or, you know, New York or Los Angeles or Miami or whatever. So that's somewhat true, but they still experience steady appreciation, probably, you know, in good times, probably 5%, maybe upwards of 7 or 8. And over 5 or 6 years, you know, that's something.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. So tell me, like, were they not rehabbing the properties as well as they had promised you? Because when someone buys a turnkey property, that they're always selling them as they're fully rehabbed, you're not going to have much maintenance. Is that just not true? Are they really kind of doing the bare minimum to sell you the property?
Well, it's, you know, it's hard to know. I mean, unless you go out and inspect every bill, you know, inspect every renovation, you really don't know. You rely basically on inspectors to give you pictures and give you information. And, you know, it's like, it's not that they do a bad job, but they don't do everything. You know, if they have an AC system and it's 5 years old, that's got another potentially 10 years on it, they're not going to replace that, you know? Mm-hmm. And so you kind of got to look at every one and decide, you know, are they doing enough? You know, you can have your mandates, like I only buy stuff where every major system is replaced, but there's a good chance that there's someone else that's like not going to say that to them, and they're just going to sell that to that person. The demand has gone up for those things, which is why the prices and the percentage, you know, versus rent versus total cost is, you know, getting more negative for the buyer, but there's a lot of competition for them. So you're not going to get the best of everything.
I mean, it sounds like you really got lucky that you hit the market right. The market appreciated, and that almost kind of saved you on those properties.
It did. Yeah. I would say I'm the lucky beneficiary of a real estate bull market for the turnkeys.
Yeah.
What I was going to say, the other thing that I did to improve the appreciation factor is this. You know, when you buy from a turnkey person, you know, they're selling you on rental rate, essentially, you know, because they know, like, hey, if this only rents for $1,000 a month, I can't charge $200,000 for it. The most I can charge is like $120,000, you know, and maybe I can sell that on the fact that I did more renovations than your average turnkeyer. But that same house in the retail market could sell for a lot more. So what I've been doing is the turnkeys I've bought from turnkey providers at a pretty good rate based on the rental, I have been selling them on the retail market when the tenants leave. And I do a fix-up on them to make them nicer. And I get a nice premium on them, I believe. So that's really boosted my appreciation. And I think that that was a pretty good strategy for mm-hmm. that. Turnover has just also been a big issue. You know, like they'll usually try to get leases that are a year and a half to maybe 2 years. And like I had one property, it's like I had like three turnovers in 4 years, like every year and a half. The tenant left, you know, and no matter what they tell you, it's going to cost you $2,500 to do a rent ready and then pretty much a month's rent for the property manager to list it and get it rented again. And God willing, you get it rented within a month, because sometimes you don't, like, you know, so ultimately it comes down to the property manager. I really feel like if you really want cash on cash return, you have to be probably getting at least hitting a 1.2% rule. Meaning if the house costs you $100,000, you got to at least be getting $1,200 a month in rent. And you have to be in a city with a low tax base that doesn't reassess their taxes every year. That's very critical. And, you know, you got to be, usually insurance does vary, but that's not that big of a deal. So you just got to factor in 30% expenses and maintenance and vacancy is the bottom line to ensure cash flow. But I feel like what with these websites and these gurus or whatever, they're selling people on, like, retirees selling their expensive house on the coast and using real estate as a way to produce cash flow for their retirement. And that's the thing that scares me the most about them, because they're selling them these turnkey packages where based on 5% expenses and turnover, so a total of 10%, they're netting an 8% cash on cash for the house, you know, for the cost of the house. And that's a surefire way to get zero cash. Mm-hmm. And when you're a retiree, you really need the cash. Like I was young and I was kind of buying for wealth building anyway, so I wasn't too concerned about cash flow. If I got it, my returns would have been better. But, you know, I was in it for long-term investment. It so happened the market's been doing well, so I'm deciding to take my chips off the table and put them elsewhere.
Let's talk about that. So today you're buying rentals closer to where you live, and are you self-managing the properties?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, again, the more you put in, the more you get out. So I'm now buying rentals, like the turnkeys are always usually two in, like, you know, the B-ish neighborhoods. If you want to take more risk and maybe get more cash flow, you go to C's. Maybe you really didn't, you know, you really got a lot of risk and you go Section 8 or whatever. I'm going more, you know, B+A neighborhoods now, which generally you would get less cash flow from in theory. But you also get a better quality tenant, so you get less headaches. I feel like the tenant maintains the property better, so you do get less expenses and ongoing stuff like that. That has been my experience so far, but it's only been 2 years for these properties. I just hear less from them, you know. And the properties will appreciate more, and I think you'll have more potential for rent increases than you do with some of the mid-tier stuff. So And the fact that I manage them, I think it makes a difference. I don't have any hard facts on this, but my feeling is this. If a tenant knows that when they call for a repair, like the tub drain is blocked, right? They know I'm going to come over with my toolbox and probably just pull a wad of hair out of the drain. Mm-hmm. They actually, I think, take a second thought and go, do I want Joe over here, you know?
Yeah,
this is a mess. I don't know. Maybe I'll just see if there's a bunch of hair in there first, and then I'll call them if it's really bad. I do think that's a factor, but I can't say for sure. I don't know. You know, you could also argue that, well, if people are less inclined to call you because of that, maybe you'll miss major maintenance issues. But I don't know. That hasn't been the case as of yet. So yeah, I just think you get overall less problems. It's overall less expense. You don't have the management cost on an ongoing basis. But more importantly, when you do have a turnover, you don't have the month's rent cost to get it rented. You're super more motivated when you're renting it yourself to get it on Zillow, you know, get it on multiple sites, not mess it up, get good photos. You know, you can screen the tenants yourself, which is definitely going to lead to better quality tenants, most likely. You do the work that you would pay them to do. So it's like you save the money and I think you get better results.
In the type of property that you're describing, in a lot of parts in the country, you're not going to be able to get the 1% rule with that type of property. Are you able to meet the 1% rule?
Now, in Florida, I'll tell you, be honest with you, I'm not besting the 1% rule. I think as you go up into better quality neighborhoods, you really can't get there. I'm more at like 0.75, 0.8% with my couple of properties right now. But they've been consistently producing positive cash flow for me. But it's because I don't have the rental cost, the management cost. I have less expenses. I have better tenants. And I, when I rent them, you know, I'm not dishing out a month's rent, you know, to get them rented. I do it myself. So,
tell me this bottom line at renting at 0.75% in Florida, where you can self-manage, are you making more money than a 1% deal in Kansas City or Memphis?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
yeah, if I were to get it to be the same, I'd have to be at 1.2% or higher, like out of state, managed by a turnkey provider, I would say.
Yeah, you know, that's I'm really glad you brought this up, because a lot of people look at the 1% rule, and if it doesn't meet the 1% rule, they're not interested. But it seems like you're doing better, and you potentially have much more upside and appreciation with the types of properties you're buying today. So is that part of your plan?
And long-term is a lot of upside, and the neighborhood has a far less chance of hitting a downward spiral. Like when you're in these neighborhoods on the cusps, you know, they can go bad, you know, property values can go down. It's happened. When you're in an A, B plus A neighborhood, it's much less likely that neighborhood would ever like turn negative. More likely it's going to turn more positive.
Yep.
In my opinion.
I agree with you. Well, if you want to learn more about Joe, you can find him at playlouder.com. I've also got a link to his contact information on my website. You can find it at rentalincomepodcast.com/episode272. I'd like to thank today's sponsor for making this episode possible. It's Chaley Ridge from Ridge Lending Group. If you're looking to buy a rental property, whether you're just getting started or you want to add to your portfolio, the lender that I recommend is Chaley Ridge. She's a nationwide lender, and she specializes in helping investors buy rental properties. She has a ton of different loan programs, and she can find something customized for you in your situation. If you want to find out more or set up a time to talk to Chaley, just go to ridgelendinggroup.com. That's R-I-D-G-E, lendinggroup.com. If you mention Rental Income Podcast, she will waive all the pre-qualification fees. NMLS 42056. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast. Make sure you subscribe. We have new interviews every single Tuesday. And if you subscribe, you'll get notified as soon as they come out. My name is Dan Lane, and this has been the Rental Income Podcast.